Dr. K.V. Rao, Professor and Principal of Indigenous Institute of Technology. Dear students, today I am going to explain fundamentals of convective heat transfer. So in this, we are going to discuss mechanism of convective heat transfer, classification of different fluids, concept of boundary layer development, and dimensionless numbers, Reynolds number, Prandtl number, Nusselt numbers in convective heat transfer. So convective heat transfer is one mode of heat transfer. There are basically heat transfer means it is an energy transfer. When there is a temperature difference, there will be heat transfer. There are three modes of heat transfer: conduction, convection, and radiation. Generally, conduction we find in solids. The heat transfer in solids, we can take it as a conduction. The heat transfer in liquids, we find it is a convective heat transfer. Liquids means it may be a gases or liquids. The heat transfer in liquids and gases, we can take it as a convective heat transfer. And coming to the radiation heat transfer, actually there is no medium is required. Without any physical contact, there is a heat transfer, we can take it as a radiation heat transfer. Today we discuss in brief about convective heat transfer. So convective heat transfer, it is a heat transfer when a fluid is flowing over a solid boundary, a solid surface. But in such cases, the heat is transferred through convection. That is, for convective heat transfers, we require there is a fluid motion. Due to fluid motion, whatever the heat transfer, that we can consider as a convective heat transfer. So due to fluid motion, it enhances the heat transfer. It increases the heat transfer. Then compared to conduction, in convection there will be more amount of heat transfer. In convective heat transfer, heat is transferred in two modes. That is, one is by diffusion, another is by advection. Diffusion means there is a heat transfer due to random molecular motion. When the molecules are in motion, the respective heat transfer we are taking is a conduction, that is by diffusion. Coming to the advection, due to the fluid movement, it is not a molecular movement, it is a fluid movement. Due to fluid movement, if there is a heat transfer, it is an advection. The total convective heat transfer is a sum of heat transfer by diffusion plus sum of heat transfer by advection. And the convective heat transfer, again, is classified as two modes of heat transfer. So first one is free convection or natural convection, and second one is a forced convection. In case of a free convection, without any external agency, if there is a heat transfer, that is called as a free convection. In free convection, we find there will be buoyancy forces. Buoyancy forces means due to hydrostatic forces, without any external agency, there will be heat transfer. Coming to the forced convection, it is a heat transfer due to some external agencies like a fan, a blower, a pump. Due to these components, it creates a fluid flow. Due to external agencies, there is a fluid flow. In particular cases, if there is a heat transfer, it is called as a forced convection. Next, how to calculate this convective heat transfer? For conductive heat transfer, we use a Fourier's equation, but how to calculate convective heat transfer? So, to calculate the convective heat transfer, we are using Natus law of
cooling
equation. So, we assume that there is a flare, where the plate of fluid is flowing, where the plate temperature is Ts, and fluid temperature is T infinity. Okay. The fluid is flowing over a plate. Plate temperature is Ts and the fluid temperature is T infinity, where H is a convective heat transfer coefficient of a particular fluid. Then heat flux or heat transfer per unit area, the small q, we can calculate as a H into Ts minus T infinity. That means here what Newton's law of cooling tells, heat flux is directly proportional to the temperature difference. If there is a temperature, if there is a more temperature difference, there will be more amount of heat flux. There will be more amount of heat transfer. This here, in convective heat transfer calculation, most of the heat transfer basically it depends upon the convective heat transfer coefficient. If convective heat transfer coefficient is more, means there will be more amount of heat transfer. If convective heat transfer coefficient is less, means there will be less amount of heat transfer. And this convective heat transfer coefficient, it depends upon so many fluid properties. So it depends upon dynamic viscosity, it depends upon thermal conductivity, it depends upon density of the fluid, and it depends upon specific heat of the fluid, and it depends upon the fluid velocity. Not only these parameters, sometimes it depends upon the geometry and roughness of the solid surface also. And if you compare the convective heat transfer coefficient for different cases, for natural convection, forced convection, heat transfer coefficient between natural convection and forced convection, natural convection heat transfer coefficient is less than forced convection. It means that in natural convection there will be less amount of heat transfer, in forced convection there is a more amount of heat transfer. There is one more heat transfer, there is a convective heat transfer, that is a phase change. In phase change, the heat transfer coefficient is more than both the cases, and here there will be a large amount of heat transfer. And for conductive heat transfer coefficient, we have the equation of minus k into dou t by dou y. And for convection, there is a Newton's law of cooling equation, that is Q equal to H into Ts minus T infinity. If you equate both the equations, because there will be, wherever there is a convection, there will be a conduction also there. First, from plate to the fluid, there will be a conductive heat transfer. From there will be a convective heat transfer. If you equate both the equations, then we will get an equation H equal to minus K into rho T by dou y divided by Ts minus T infinity. Using this equation, we can find out convective heat transfer coefficient. So this is the equation, combined equation of conductive and convective heat transfer coefficients. Now we'll see what are the different types of flow in convective heat transfer coefficient. So convective heat transfer coefficient we'll discuss for various viscous flows and non-viscous flows. And there will be internal flows and external flows. In both the cases, we have to find out what is the convective heat transfer coefficient, how much heat transfer takes place. Similarly, there will be compressible flows and incompressible flows. There will be natural flows and there will be forced flows. Steady flow and unsteady flow, and one-dimensional flow, two-dimensional flow, three-dimensional flows, and the another very important fluid flow is laminar flow and turbulent flow. In all the cases, we have to discuss how the convective heat transfer takes place. So coming to these flows, generally in viscous flows, there will be between the fluid layers there will be more amount of friction. So viscous flow means flow in which frictional effects are significant, called viscous effects. And non-inviscid flows, there won't be any frictional effects between the fluid layers. Coming to the internal flows and external flows, if there is a flow over a flat plate, we can take it as external flow. If there is a flow inside the tubes and there is a flow in a channels, we can take it as a internal flows. Compressible flows and incompressible flows means if the density of the fluids remains constant, it is called as an incompressible flow. Or if the density is not constant, if density is changing, then we can take it as a compressible flows. Generally, our study, we assume that the fluid is incompressible and we do all the calculations in most of the cases. Coming to the steady flow and unsteady flow means, steady flow means at any particular point, irrespective of time, the properties, the velocity and other properties are not changing, then it is a steady flow. Unsteady flow means at any given particular fixed point, if the properties are changing with respect to time, it is an unsteady flow. And uniform and non-uniform flow means no change with location is uniform flow, and if there is a change means it is a non-uniform. One-dimensional flow means if the flow is only is a function of x, it is a one-dimensional. If the flow is only function of x and y, it is a two-dimensional. If the flow is a function of x, y and z, it is called as a three-dimensional flow. Sometimes we use Cartesian coordinates and sometimes we use cylindrical coordinates in some objects. And there is another important flows, laminar and turbulent. So these flows are very important as far this convective heat transfer is concerned. So laminar flow means if the flow is very smooth, if the flow is a streamlined flow, it is called as a laminar flow. Okay. So if you observe in both the cases, so this is a gas burner. See, so this is a gas burner. When there is a flare, from the burner. Initially, the smoke, you will find there is a uniform streamlined smoke. After some distance, there will be a zigzag. Okay, this streamlined portion is an example of laminar flow. This zigzag portion is an example of a turbulent. Similarly, there is another example. So we discuss laminar flow. Turbulent flow means if the flow is not smooth, if the flow is not streamlined, if the flow is in a zigzag manner, it is called as a turbulent flow. Okay. So if you observe in this example, there is a pipe. So the fluid is flowing in a pipe. Fluid is flowing in a pipe, and here there is a small arrangement for dye injection, a color dye injection. If you inject for some distance, if the fluid inside the pipe where the fluid is flowing very smooth, for some distance the injection will be a straight line motion. Then we can understand that the flow is laminar flow. So, in case of turbulent flow, okay, so due to dye injections, we find there will be a zigzag portion. When the dye is moving in a zigzag manner, we can understand that inside the pipe, the flow is not a smooth. The flow is at a high velocity, it is not a streamline. Then we have to understand that it is a turbulent flow. Like this, we can understand whether the flow is a laminar or turbulent with the help of a dye injection. So that is laminar flow and the turbulent flow we have discussed for an internal flow. Now we will see for external flow how this laminar and turbulent layers takes place. Okay. So there is a plate. Over the plate a fluid is flowing with uniform velocity of V. See, over a plate, the fluid is flowing. So this is a plate. The fluid is flowing with the uniform velocity of V. Due to the flow over a plate, what happens is there is a border layer takes place. Okay. So here we find there is a border layer flow and there is a outside the border layer flow. So due to border layer, what happens means where the fluid touches the plate, where the velocity becomes zero, and at the surface of the plate, entire surface of the plate, the velocity is zero, and slowly the velocity increases from the plate. Okay, and for some portion of the plate, we find that there will be a smooth flow of velocity inside the border layer, a streamlined flow of velocity inside the border layer. That portion is called as a laminar border layer. Okay, and after some distance, after laminar border layer, what happens means the fluid starts disturbing. There is a deviation of fluid flow. This is called a transition border layer. After some distance, what happens means we find inside the border layer there will be some
the fluid is in a zigzag manner. So that portion we can call as a turbulent water layer. Above the water layer, the velocity will be similar to the free stream velocity, but only the inside the water layer only the velocity is changing. At the surface of the plate, the velocity is zero, and slowly velocity increases. At some point of time, at some point, the velocity becomes equal to the 99% of the free stream velocity, and the particular thickness we can call as boundary layer thickness. Okay, where the velocity becomes the free stream velocity, the particular distance we can call it as boundary layer thickness. Apart from this, this turbulent boundary layer again we are subdivided into a few various layers: viscous sublayer, buffer layer, overlap layer, and turbulent layer. Top portion of the turbulent boundary layer we call as a turbulent boundary layer, and over the surface we can call as a viscous layer. Above that there is a buffer layer. Above that there will be overlap layer. This is regarding to the laminar and turbulent flows. Coming to the boundary layer development, as we discussed, there is a plate. Over the plate there is a fluid is flowing with a velocity of u infinity. U infinity is a free stream velocity. When the fluid it touches the plate, due to the contact, the velocity at the leading edge, this is called as a starting point, you can call as a leading edge, and the last point you can call as a trailing edge. Where the fluid touches the leading edge, the velocity becomes zero, and slowly the velocity increases, and the flow is divided into two sections. One is a boundary layer flow and outside the boundary layer flow. This boundary layer flow is a very very thin section, and here from surface to boundary layer, so velocity slowly increases, and inside the boundary layer what happens is there will be viscous effects, there will be frictional forces. So due to frictional forces there will be some drag force acts on the surfaces or plate. And here we have to discuss what is meant by boundary layer thickness. Boundary layer thickness means, so from the surface of the plate, slowly the velocity increases. Where the velocity reaches 99% of the free stream velocity, that is called as a boundary layer thickness. Okay. So here we are discussing velocity is a velocity boundary layer thickness. Similar to that, we have to discuss the thermal boundary layer also. And here, during the flow, we assume that there is a no slip. So, over the boundary layer, the velocity is u equal to 0.99 v. That means where it reaches 99% velocity, so particular velocity thickness we can take as a boundary layer thickness, delta. And so in the boundary layer, due to the very less velocities, and over the surface the velocity is zero, and there will be very less velocities. Due to less velocities means there are a frictional forces. Where there is a frictional forces between the layers of a fluid, there will be shear stresses. So how to calculate the shear stresses means, here shear stresses developed due to the velocity velocity gradient. Okay. Due to change of velocities, there will be shear stresses. To calculate the shear stresses, we use the equation called tau s equal to mu into dou u by dou y at y equal to 0. Y equal to 0 means over the surface of the plane. Okay. And the fluids which obey this equation is called as Newtonian fluids. So this is a linear equation. What are the fluids which obey this equation? We can take it as a Newtonian fluid. Similar to that, there will be a thermal boundary layer also we can find over a flow. Okay. So, very similar flow, that means there will be a flow over your flat plate. In previous cases, we discussed only how the velocity changes. So here, the temperature of the plate is Ts and the temperature of the fluid is T infinity. And when the fluid is flowing over a plate, there will be a boundary layer formation takes place. Okay, so inside the boundary layer, there will be a fluid flow and there will be a lot of frictional forces. And same time, what happens means there is a heat transfer from this plate to the fluid. So there will be a heat transfer takes place. Due to heat transfer, what happens means the temperature of the fluid inside the boundary layer we can calculate using this equation. And slowly temperature reduce and there will be more temperature over a surface display. And when we are moving towards vertical, slowly there will be heat transfer, even though the temperature slowly it reduces, and at one point of time it becomes equal to the fluid velocity. Okay, where the temperature of the fluid it reaches to the free stream temperature, the particular height or the particular distance we can call as a boundary layer thickness delta suffix T. So this is a temperature difference between this boundary layer T minus Ts, where it reaches 99% of this Ts minus T infinity, that particular height we can take it as a boundary layer thickness, thermal boundary layer thickness. The thickness of the thermal boundary layer increases in the flow direction. Okay, when x increases, boundary layer thickness also it increases, and the convective heat transfer rate anywhere along the surface is directly proportional to the temperature gradient. Where the temperature gradient or the temperature difference is more, the heat transfer also more. And in the convective heat transfer, so many cases the problems are very complicated. There are more number of variables are involved. To simplify the problems, we are using some non-dimensional numbers. Okay, so in non-dimensional number there will be some parameters we are attached to the non-dimensional number. Like this, we can simplify this the complex convective heat transfer problem. In that, we are going to discuss Nusselt number, Reynolds number and Prandtl number. These are the three non-dimensional numbers which plays a vital role in the convective heat transfer. So first we will discuss Nusselt number. So Nusselt number means this is HL by K. Nusselt number means HL by K. Or this Nusselt number, we can define it as, it is a ratio of convective heat transfer by conductive heat transfer. Nusselt number is nothing but, we define it is a ratio of convective heat transfer by conductive heat transfer. Okay. Once if you know some Nusselt number, you can easily find out heat transfer coefficient. If you are able to find out the heat transfer coefficient, you can find out the amount of convective heat transfer. There is one more non-dimensional number, that is called Prandtl number. So Prandtl is a scientist. He did a lot of contribution in convective heat transfer. And even the boundary layer concept also was introduced by the Prandtl. The Prandtl number, we can define it as molecular diffusivity of momentum divided by molecular diffusivity of heat. Molecular diffusivity of momentum is nothing but mu divided by alpha. Again, mu we can write it as a, then again this we can simplify it as a mu Cp by K. Or sometime this Prandtl number we can define it as, it is a ratio of thermal boundary layer by lambda boundary layer thicknesses, delta T by delta. For liquid metals, the Prandtl number is less than 1, and for some oils, Prandtl number is greater than 1. If Prandtl number is less than 1, there is a more amount of heat transfer. If Prandtl number is greater than 1, there will be less amount of heat transfer. So the thermal boundary layer is much thicker than for liquid metals and much thinner for oils and relative to the velocity boundary layer. So next non-dimensional number is Reynolds number. So this is it plays is also one of the very important non-dimensional numbers. Based on this Reynolds number, we can identify that whether the flow is laminar or turbulent. And the Reynolds number we can define it as, it is a ratio of inertia forces by viscous forces. So that is VLC by nu. Again, so the viscosity, you can, again this equation again you can simplify it as rho V L by nu. Rho means density of fluid, V means velocity, and L means that length of the laminar layer or whatever it may be. And nu is dynamic. Dynamic viscosity of the fluid. Okay. So generally in the fluid flow, so the inertia forces are more than the viscous forces. And over a flow, some portion is a laminar flow, after that there will be a turbulent flow. So how to define, how to identify whether it is a laminar turbulent flow means, with the help of some values we can identify. Suppose if it is internal flow, if there is a flow over a pipeline, if the Reynolds number is less than 2300, we can take it as a laminar flow. If the Reynolds number is greater than 2300, we can take it as a turbulent flow. So if the laminar, if the Reynolds number is 2300, then we can take it as a critical Reynolds number. Okay. So before the critical Reynolds number, the flow is laminar. After the critical Reynolds number, the flow is turbulent. Like this, with the help of the Reynolds number, we can identify whether the flow is turbulent. Most of the convective heat transfer problems, the first what to do means, we should identify whether the flow is laminar or turbulent. To identify the laminar or turbulent means, we should calculate the Reynolds number. based on the calculation of Reynolds number, we can go further to calculate the convective heat transfer. And since it is a fluid flow, the fluid flow is governed by a few differential equations, that is quantity equation and momentum equation and energy equation. We take a small element of dx, dy and dz. For that, the fluid is flowing in x direction with the velocity of u and y direction with the velocity of v. Since continuity equation, we take that the discharge, for a constant discharge, if you take the balance equation, you can get a partial equation of partial differential equation of dou u by dou x plus dou v by dou y equal to 0. This is a continuity equation. Similar to that, for a particular element, if you take the momentum, you will get this equation. It's a momentum equation. And we take the energy flowing over a particular particular element, we will take energy equation like this. So these are the three governing equations for any fluid flow. With the help of these equations, we derive so many flow equations like Navier-Stokes equations, okay, like that. So these are the some fundamentals heat transfer, convective heat transfer concept we have discussed today's class. So we have discussed about what is meant by convective heat transfer, what are the different types of convective heat transfer, natural convection, forced convection, what are the different flows, what is meant by boundary layer, what is meant by laminar boundary layer, and what is meant by double boundary layer. Okay. And apart from this, we have discussed what is the importance of non-dimensional numbers. And for convective heat transfer problems, there are three non-dimensional numbers: Nusselt number, Prandtl number, and Reynolds number, and what is its importance. Today we will discuss. Thank you.